I shot this short intro and add that cartoony-like VFX because today we're talking about passes and compositing. In a race for better realism, we always think about the ways to enhance the image. Sometimes we're looking at the image and thinking, I wish I could increase the intensity of this light. There is one important production stage where the realism of your work can skyrocket. And it's of course compositing stage. So what's compositing exactly? Compositing is the process of combining visual elements from different sources. Classic example of that is live footage and CG elements. That's why I shot that opening video. So render passes. You might heard about them before or you're using them already. And I'm pretty sure you've seen Hollywood blockbusters breakdowns. These breakdowns is exactly what it is. It's just overlaid passes on top of each other. Passes are used to get greater creative control and achieve maximum realism. Basically, you're rendering your CG scene separated into different elements. For example, color data in one pass, reflections data in second pass, lights data in third pass. So you can change the intensity of particular lights or change the color of reflections and things like that without destroying the rest of the scene. Passes can also store some technical data like Z depth, which represents the depth of your scene, motion vectors that records the movements of your objects in your scene, and this allows to motion blur stuff later. So you can use all these passes to integrate elements in post. For instance, if I would have, I don't know, a floor with a custom reflection, grungy reflection, and I would want to put a character shot on green screen. I would want him to be reflected in that custom reflection, but how would I do it? Firstly, I would take the character and put him on plane, obviously, then flip him vertically, and with passes, I would tell his reflections where to appear. Simple as that. That all sounds great, but you might wonder which passes you should use. And as I usually do, I will say it depends. Depends on the scene, on the task, on the pipeline. Depends on what you need to do. Let's run through all the passes and then you would know what you can do. In Cinema 4D settings, go to Octane and click Render Passes tab. You can see some general settings and tabs separating available passes. Beauty passes. Here are all the passes that are used in actual compositing. Render layer allows you to render desired elements on transparent background and include shadows on transparent background as well. I'll explain a bit later. Lighting passes. This tab allows to include all desired lights in separate passes. Render layer mask. These passes are used to render separate masks for separate objects. Info passes. All technical passes like Z-depth, vertexes, wireframes, etc. Material passes. Allows to have passes separated by materials channels. I might be a dummy, but I haven't found a use case for these passes since I have all necessary passes available in Beauty Passes tab. So I would like to show you the passes that I use the most. I prepared a scene that will help me to explain how everything works. Let's hit render and open up Cinema 4D settings again. First thing you want to check in render passes is obviously enable checkbox. This is your save path, format, choose EXR. I will explain why a bit later. Depth, 32 bits. Remember our 32-bit versus 8-bit image comparison from previous tutorial. Yep. Compression, live as is. Don't save beauty as we're saving beauty path through Cinema's 4D settings anyway. Multi-layer file, yes please. That way you won't have a mess in your folders. Color profile and tone map type should be set to linear. I will briefly explain linear workflow later too. Now, you might get away with sRGB and tone map versions if you don't want to mess with linear. Today though, we will render everything out in linear color space. Finally, let's start exploring passes. In beauty passes, on the bottom of the tab, you have a select and unselect all buttons. Hit select all. In your live viewer, you can see additional tabs appeared. By clicking each of them, you're selecting the pass. We don't need all of them, but just to see what they do, let's click each tab. Emitters, the pass that contains all emitters in it. You probably noticed neon signs on the walls in my scene. So why aren't they here in this pass? Because they are obscured with glass. So I have glass cover and emitter inside of it. If I'll disable glass, they will appear here. I will actually leave it like that since there is no difference. Environment. This pass ignores all the objects in the scene and renders your environment only. If you're using HDRI maps, it will render it. It's useful, I guess. I never use it, so I'll disable it. Diffuse pass contains all the color data of the scene. Usually, I'm not using it because two next passes giving me more control. Diffuse direct and diffuse indirect are representing colors affected by lights. So you can see that diffuse direct colors are affected by kind of ambient light, and diffuse indirect pass stores the colors that are result of additional lights and emitters affection. Diffuse filter is kind of raw representation of the colors in your scene. I never use it. Reflection stores all the reflections in it. But same as with diffuse, two next passes allow better control. So I'm not using this one usually. Reflection direct and reflection indirect works same as diffuse pass, but with reflections. Reflection filter shows more or less reflective areas of your scene. Usually I'm not using it too. Refraction is the pass that saves all your specular, transparent objects in a separate pass. This is useful if you want to adjust content that is behind these transparent objects. For instance, something that is behind the window glass. Particularly useful in architecture renders. Refraction filter is the pass to quickly see which areas of your scene has specularity in them. Transmission would store transmission if I would have it in my scene. Well, actually, let's quickly add it to the character's hair. Here you go. Here is our transmission. Transmission filter. As all other filters, just specify which objects have transmission. Subsurface scattering glow would be here. I don't have any in this scene, so I'll disable it too. Postpass stores all those fancy glows and glares produced by your Octane camera tag. LastPass, which I actually always use, is NoisePass. It only appears if you're rendering with adaptive sampling enabled. The reason I include it is that a lot of times I have to use third-party denoisers in post. And with this pass, it may be easier to capture noise pattern. Okay, all done with beauty passes. I'll skip render layer for now, we will get back to it. Lighting passes. In Octane, you can render up to 8 separate light passes. First, let me show you how to specify light ID in your lights. I have 3 light sources in my scene. Click Octane Light tag. In Light Settings on the bottom, you can see Light Pass ID section. This is where you specify your light's ID. Keep in mind that if multiple light sources will have same light ID, they will render in the same pass. For these 3 lights, I specified different light IDs. You can also specify light IDs in your emitting materials. Under emission settings, you can see the same light pass ID section. I already assigned unique numbers to all my lights. Let's enable lighting passes. Ambient light pass. This is the light from your environment maps. Sunlight pass would store sunlight if we would have any in this scene. Light pass 1. This light stores our warm light with ID number 1. Let's enable the rest of the lights. See how cool it is. By doing it, you will have the opportunity to manipulate your lights in post. Alright, lighting passes sorted. Info passes. In this tab, I will only show you the passes that I use in my workflow. Geometry normals, vertex normals, and shading normals. Usually these passes are used to add lights or shadows if necessary. Geometry normals are normals of your geometry without materials in consideration. Same as vertex normals, but geometry is smoothed out. I usually use shading normals because they include your materials normals if there are any. Z-depth pass. I'm pretty sure many of you are familiar with this. It's used to add things like smokes and particles into your scene. Previously, I used it to add depth of field to my works in post, but since I'm rendering depth of field and motion blur in Octane, I don't really use it anymore. But let's leave it. Matte ID. Sometimes I use this pass. It assigns random colors to all materials, and in post, you can key out necessary material. It's not too effective as Octane assigns colors with similar tones, and sometimes it's impossible to separate them. Object ID pass. Let's assign Octane object tag to our character. In object layer, you see several sections. We need layer ID 1. Let's put 7 in it. Look what happened. This object is now separated from all other objects. All other objects' ID is set to 1 by default. This is why all the scene looks blue, because it is all treated as one. Object layer color pass is my preferable way of masking out different scene objects. Let's assign green color to object's color. For each object, I can manually set desired color. This is the reason why using matte ID and other similar passes makes no sense to me. Wireframe and ambient occlusion passes can be used in breakdowns because they look cool. There is no other practical use for them. Right, so we discussed main render passes. Now, let's render this scene out with all the passes. When it comes to rendering and settings, you want the best quality possible. It is achievable using 32-bit images and linear workflow. With linear workflow, the calculation of light and color through the whole process from render setup to post will be correct. Since linear workflow is a big topic by itself, I won't talk about it much. I'll only say that this workflow allows you to render correct 32-bit images that contains a lot of data in them. The workflow I'm showing you will be linear by default. So once everything is ready and we chose all the passes we want, it's time to talk about EXR file format. So why EXR? EXR is the high dynamic range file format developed specifically for VFX production pipelines. It allows to store all desired CG passes in one file with lossless or lossy compressions. It takes less space on your hard drive and stores all necessary info for high-end compositing. TIFF, for instance, would render each pass in a separate file. First movies where EXR files were used were Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone, Men in Black 2, and Gangs of New York. Thought it's a nice, interesting fact for you. Now you know why we are rendering in EXR and we can hit that render button. It says it will render for 5 hours on my single 1080 Ti card. I don't want to wait that long, so I will send this scene to my studio workstation and use render font to render it out. By the way guys, you are asking a lot about my PC build. If you haven't subscribed already, you better do so, because in a couple of weeks guys, I'll show you how to build a water-cooled PC with multi-GPU in it. I'll explain which parts and why you should use. While I was saying this long entertaining sentence, render finished. Depending on what your project is, you will compose your scene either in Photoshop for stills or Fusion for animations. Of course, you can do stills in Fusion too if you wish. Yes, you can do it in After Effects, but I would like to show you Fusion and Photoshop workflows. Since After Effects and Photoshop are layer-based editors, workflow will be the same. Let's open up Fusion first. As usual, Control Space Loader. There is only one sequence in your folder. Load it. When you press 1, black screen appears in your first preview window. Seems like the imported sequence is corrupted or rendered incorrectly. Multipass compositing in Fusion using EXR files needs more steps to work properly. With the node selected, go to your Format tab. Under Channels, you see variety of available channels. This time we only need 3, red, green and blue. Expand red list. Here they are, all our passes in this enormous list. I will start with diffuse pass. Choose desired pass for each channel. Diffuse direct red on red channel, diffuse direct green on green channel, and diffuse direct blue on blue channel. Now we see something, but it's too dark. This is linear gamma space affecting our image. After Effects would show you corrected gamma, but in Fusion, to see your pass properly, you need to take additional step. Press Ctrl space and type in gamut. In the settings, change output color space to sRGB. Drag this node into preview window and voila. I will do the same for all other passes now. Once you have imported all your passes, you can merge them together. To do so, just in case you don't know, grab this red output square from this node and drag it to the output of the previous one. That way, we're telling Fusion we want this node to be on top of the first one. Fusion automatically creates merge node. Repeat that until all the passes are linked together. Now, if you will preview your last node, you will only see your last pass, which in our case is post. That's because we haven't selected any overlay modes yet. In merge nodes, select screen as your blending mode. The final image is a bit too bright and we will have to adjust everything manually. And to be honest, I prefer it that way because that's where creative process starts. I can adjust and manipulate stuff. I can start crafting the image. This particular workflow in Fusion is quite a bit inconvenient. Nuke is doing much better job with EXR files, but I still use Fusion because it's free and studio version is cheap. I can do all I need in it. After all your passes are merged together, you can start playing around, adding elements like rain in our case and so on. Fusion workflow is most suitable for animation, but what if you want to compose a still image? You can do the same thing in Photoshop. If you will open EXR file in Photoshop, all you will see will be black screen. But there is a great little plugin for Photoshop called EXR.io. It's free and link is in description. Download it, install it and try to open your EXR again. Now, new dialog window pops up. After importing your EXR, you now have all its data separated in passes. I'll get rid of these folders as they're supposed to store separate alpha data for each pass. Then I will move our info passes up and disable them. After that, select all your passes and choose linear dodge overlay mode. Same way as in Fusion, you can now start adjusting your image. Usually I do all the compositing work in Fusion, doesn't matter, still, video, because I like node workflow. I do final retouch in Photoshop once main compositing is done. Now you know everything about passes and how to deal with them in Fusion and Photoshop. But how to compose CG elements on top of live footage? You thought I forgot about the main purpose of this tutorial? Let's open our scene in Cinema 4D and get rid of everything except of our character. Now, I took this picture of a lovely Winchester's alley another day, and this is what we will use as our live shot. Now I will create a plane and place it behind our character. Create diffuse material and load our photo to diffuse channel. Assign the material to our backdrop and in texture settings choose camera mapping as your projection mode. Drag and drop our scene camera to the camera section and here you go. Image is now projected properly. The only thing left to change is aspect ratio, which should be 16:9. As for the camera, the shot was made on full frame camera with 16mm lens. Knowing this is very useful as your scene's perspective will perfectly match the shot's perspective. See that grid line? It's matching the ground tiles. I will now create the floor and the walls the same way. Floor is perfectly aligned to the shot. Control drag the material on top of the newly created plane and we have our projection on it since we already configured this material's projection mode. The floor and the walls will serve as a shadow catchers for us. Look what we have. It's a rough representation of the alley on the photo. Let's render it. I'll get rid of the lights from our previous scene version. The best way to recreate lights is to use HDRI map from the same location. You can check out my tutorial on how to do that. In this case, I'm using another HDRI map that has similar lighting and it works pretty good. If I place a light source behind the character, you can see the shadows more obviously. That's all good, but how to divide character from the background to be able to compose it later? Open up Cinema's 4D settings and go to Octane Passes. I'll disable all the passes that we discussed previously and will enable diffuse, reflection, refraction and post only. On our character, we already had an object tag assigned and we specified layer ID as 7. Go to passes and now we will talk about render layer section. Enable it. Now you only see black background. Put our object's ID into layer ID. Now our character is rendering on black background. You need to enable alpha in Octane settings. Our character is receiving colors and shadows from our environment but is rendered on transparency. Enable black shadows and reflections. New pass tabs appeared in Live Viewer. We have separate shadows on transparency. Let's render this out. This time we will compose this in Fusion despite it's a still image. Control, space, loader, and load our background photo. I rendered CG scene in 4K. Photo is much bigger than this, so I'll use resize node to match the sizes. Now I will load in all our passes same way as we did it previously, but this time under channels I will also select alpha for each pass. Because this time we actually have alpha channels. Merge all the passes together. This pass came out weird. I'll get rid of it. This is pretty much all you need to know to compose stuff in different ways. You have control over separate CG passes, which gives you great creative freedom. You can start adding elements that you want. I used exactly the same technique to create that intro video. The only difference was that instead of still, I used video. And it involves tracking, masking, animating, and all that jazz. Irrelevant to this tutorial. Thumbs up if you're pumped to try what you learned. By the way, for the opening scene you've seen in the beginning, I animated a cloud. You can buy it for £1. It's an animated VDB sequence from Houdini. Pre-configured Octane scene in Cinema 4D, lights animated through Expresso, and if you have X particles, you will have rain in it. Link in video description. Apart from the cloud, I actually modeled my umbrella, which I have in real life. Just wanted to say that, cause yeah. That's it for this tutorial, guys. Subscribe if you wish to step up your VFX game, and I see you soon. Peace!